Hello everyone. Before we start, let's take a walk down the memory lane. 2017 has been undoubtedly one of the best years for the Indian stock market. However, starting February 2018, markets started consolidating and witnessed another correction in the history of Indian stock market. Fortunately, this downfall did not last long and markets recovered quickly. To everyone's surprise, the benchmark equity indices Sensex and Nifty marked their new lifetime high. With this stellar show of the Indian stock markets, it's not hard to pay heed to the underlying fear. Are we heading towards the next market crisis? With the uncertainty in the Indian stock market, the dilemma of every Indian investor is hard to ignore. Where the markets are headed? Is it time to invest or hold? When should I enter and when should I exit? To solve this complex puzzle, let's hear out from the experts. Mr. Manish Goyal, who's the founder at Research and Banking, and Ms. Mayuri Yadav, Associate Director. Mayuri, as I mentioned, that the benchmark equity indices are marking new highs. What do you think are the contributing factors to this ongoing rally in the stock market?
Yeah. See, the fundamental strength of Indian economy is a reality. You know, every time we have seen phases of correction in the market, primarily due to the international news flow, markets, Indian markets have bounced back very quickly. So, the resilience of our markets actually emanates from the structural strengths in our economy. We at R&R truly believe that Indian markets are in for a secular bull run for the next many years to come. If I really have to explain what has happened in the last few trading sessions when NSE and Sensex touched all-time highs, I would largely contribute this to the very strong Q1 19 earning result season, where all the companies in our universe have at least delivered 25 to 30% return. I would say, except for cement PSU banks, all the companies in our universe have delivered very, very strong EPS growth. And not only that, all these companies have even shown very strong improvement in balance sheet parameters. So this has been the key driving factor for the markets to touch all-time highs. And yes, as we read in papers, the GDP is on a recovery path, and various international agencies today are again attesting our view on GDP that it will be growing at 7.5 to 7.7%. Right. So that again becomes a contributing factor if one is willing to take a slightly longer term view on our economy and on our markets. Additionally, increasing GST collection month on month, gives confidence to an investor that the deficit target which the government set out in the budget, if they are not able to meet, at least they will come very close to it, given rising GST collections. So that gives hope in the minds of an investor. Finally, I would say even FPIs, consistently they have been sellers right from the start of this year. Especially during April to June, there was an outflow of 60 billion. And in the month of August itself, we have seen 75 billion coming back to the markets through FPI route. That in a way shows strength and confidence building in the earnings trajectory of our companies. So overall, we feel that yes, the markets, the Sensex and Nifty have touched all-time highs. But if you really dig a little deeper, you would find that this rally is largely concentrated in the large cap space. Mid cap and small cap are yet to contribute in this rally. Right. So overall, yes, markets have been going up, but it has to be more broad-based now, is what we think.
And to add to what Mayuri just said, See, all-time high is just a number. So number is coming from the history that for the first time market, so Nifty touched 11,500 or whatever it touched. If you see, all these factors are contributing to the growth of the Indian economy. So we are hopeful, as we have seen in the current quarter, that earning growth is also now happening or started happening. Markets will touch new highs, you know, in the years to come. So it's just a number. I mean, which probably for the first time it touched 11,500, so we are saying all time high. Needless to say, in the years to come, it will even touch 12,000 or 13,000 or 15,000 or probably 20,000. When it touched 10,000 for the first time, it was an event. But when it touched 1,000 also for the first time 15 years back, it was an event at that time. So it touched 1,000 whenever 15 years back, 15 years later it touched 10,000. Probably 5 years later or 10 years later, it will touch even 50,000. So it's just a number. One must track growth in the businesses, growth in the economy. What market is making new high is just a number.
But then, as mentioned by Mayuri, that this uptick has primarily because of the large cap stocks. And if we see in the past, that small cap and mid cap have tanked sharply in the last few months. What do you think has been the reason behind the same?
Yeah, you're very right in pointing that out. As we were discussing earlier, that the rally has been more concentrated in the large cap space, and the mid cap and small cap have not participated. In fact, if you see, right from the start of this year, the mid cap index and the small cap index has corrected 20-25%, right? Whereas Sensex in the same period has delivered 7-10% return. Right. So the main reason what we can identify is that this can be traced back to the circular sent out by SEBI to mutual fund houses, saying that they will have to reclassify now all the schemes under large cap, mid cap and small cap. So in a way, what happened was that all the large cap schemes now necessarily have to have 80% of their holdings in the large cap companies, whereas for mid cap, at least 65% of their holding now.
The problem was not really mid cap, large cap that way. Problem was the definition of large cap, mid cap. So as per the circular Mayuri is talking about, only first top 100 market cap companies are large cap. Only 100. And what happened if I am a fund and I have to exit something and I have to buy something, and it has to be done kind of in no time, because there was a date given. So what I would do, I will first go and pick up the first 10. So that's what you will see, that if you just remove the performance of those 10 stocks in the large cap segment as well, you'll see markets have not really made a new high. Obviously, technically it has made a new high, but if you just remove the upside delivered by those first top 10 stocks, it has not really made a new high. As a fund manager, if I have to take this action in no time, the safest bet would be this only, that I exit whatever I am supposed to exit from the mid cap or small cap segment and go and buy first top 10. So that's what happened.
Sure.
Which will now, as Mayuri is pointing out, over a period of time will stabilize.
Correct.
Now, obviously, I know what is the new norm. As a fund manager or as an investor, I know what is the new norm. So I will probably now do that much more research, and considering all of this has happened, quite a few businesses delivered good upside, top line, bottom line growth in the recent quarter are available at a very attractive valuation because of this carnage or whatever the new rule came in.
Right. So, in retrospect, as Manish is pointing out, we really find that this correction has been good for a long-term investor. Say, in November and December, the companies which were looking exorbitantly expensive, now there is value emerging. These companies, fundamentally, they have been doing extremely well. But 8-9 months back, they were equally expensive. But now, because of this correction, there is value that has emerged in the space. So we really feel that very soon even these companies will start participating in the rally, so to say, which is largely concentrated as of now in the large cap space.
So talking about the valuation, the approximate multiple of PE is trading around 28-29 times. Looking at that number, the markets are looking overvalued. So considering this, do you think this is the right time for a novice investor to enter the markets and consider fresh positions in the market?
Right. Gina, let us be clear. What is value when it comes to equity investing? It has two parts to it, right? One is multiple, which we in layman terms we call as a PE or multiple. Second is EPS, you know. So as long as EPS of a company is growing at 30-35% year on year, we believe that the multiples eventually will align itself to reflect the underlying strength, underlying fundamentals of that company. No, so what we really at R&R believe is have a bottom-up approach. Identify companies that can deliver 30-35% return in next 5-6 years, and PE can at times will go down, can re-rate upward basis market conditions, any news flow in the sector, but over a long term it will align, it will reflect business moat and fundamental strength of that company.
But do you think that the headwinds such as depreciating currency or even trade war can hamper this growth of the business overall? Do you think that the markets are heading towards crisis, something similar which we saw in the year 2000, the dot-com bubble, or something like a 2008 global recession? Do you think that can happen in the near future?
So what is crisis? It's very important that we first understand the right meaning of crisis. This market's going down by 5%, 10%, that is not a crisis. That is, as Malibu rightly just pointed out, is an opportunity to buy good businesses at a lower level. Crisis is a real prolonged situation in an economy when the growth has really gone down, or in fact negative growth in an economy. In such a situation, you will see markets going down continuously for a period of 6 months, 1 year, because there is no growth in the economy. And if there is no growth in the economy, you will find very few businesses which are delivering good numbers and positive growth. So, because of all that, you will see markets have gone down substantially to the extent of 40%, 50%, 60%. And that happens over a period of time. And recovery happens gradually as and when growth starts happening again. We are already growing at 7% or more than 7%. Likely to, grow probably at a higher rate in the years to come. So we are definitely not heading towards a crisis-like situation. In fact, after many years of, low growth and businesses not reporting good numbers, this is the first quarter we have seen that there's enough demand in the economy. Credit growth is picking up, capacity utilization is picking up. So 5% correction, 10% correction is not a crisis. It's definitely not heading towards a crisis in the near future.
True. So agreed, it may not be a crisis, as mentioned by you, that a 5% or 10% correction is not called as market crash or crisis. But many investors are anticipating corrections to the tune of say 5-10%. Do you think that can be a reason to worry?
Why? I mean, if you know what you are getting into, how that can be a reason to worry? If you are not following share price, if you are following growth in the business, how that can be a reason to worry? I would be very happy if I am planning to buy something today at 100, and just because of the 5% correction or 8% correction, if that happens, the same business is available at 92, I would be the first person who will go and buy the business. If I know what I am getting in. This 5% correction, 8% correction is a worry for people who try to track the price on a daily basis, number one. Number two, don't know the growth prospects of the business they are getting into. For those set of people, it is a worry. If I am tracking the price on a daily basis, even if I have bought an excellent business, Yes, if this 5% correction or 8% correction happens, even that business will go down by 2% or 5% or I don't know what percent. But then I should not worry about it because I know what I bought.
But this normally looks easier said than done. Whenever there is a market correction, many investors get into a panic mode and there is a frenzied selling which we see in the stock market, due to which the prices even drive further down. So, what can
that be? Is the challenge. That is the challenge. I get into panic mode as an investor. I start selling without knowing, you know, what is crisis, what is a normal correction, what is that I am holding. That is the challenge. That is why investing is, very few people make money in investing. It's an skill. I mean, it's an art, it's a skill. Because if I have bought an excellent business, it is growing quarter on quarter, year on year, and just because there is a correction, 5%, 8%, 10%, I get panicked and I sell the business, how can I do that? And if I do that, how will I make it big? You forget about this 5%, 8% correction, talk about any crisis you just talked about, dot-com bubble or global recession 2008, 2009, or any previous crisis. You will see markets have recovered substantially. I mean, any crisis you pick up, 97, 2000, 2008, you'll see markets have done probably 6 times, 7 times, 8 times since each crisis, any of the crises you analyze. And more interesting is, you analyze a few businesses. Businesses have grown 100 times, 50 times, 200 times. And this I am saying, any crisis you pick up, whether 97 or 2000 or 2008 or any before that. Because if there is growth in the business, and it doesn't have to be really a small cap name, like, you know, from last 2008 or whatever year, businesses have grown 50 times, 100 times, they were small cap companies, now they have become mid cap or large cap. It's not like that. Businesses of many, so-called large caps have also grown, to the extent of 20, 50 times. You see where IndusInd Bank was 2008, where it is today. Where Bajaj Finance was, where it is today. Where TCS was, where it is today. So there is growth in the business. Business have been going up and becoming even 20, 50 times in a matter of 8, 10 years. What we are bothered about, okay, whether 5% correction will happen or not. When will it happen? If it happens, what will happen to my portfolio? So on one side, there is a situation like, I just talked about TCS or IndusInd Bank or Bajaj Finance or many which have delivered 50 times, 100 times, 200 times, and there are many which may, probably deliver same or similar kind of growth over next 5, 10 years, 15 years. Because if there is growth in the business, the same story will be. That is what Mayuri just talked about, ki we are only tracking growth in the businesses, and if there is growth, 30-35% bottom line growth in the businesses, there is nothing to worry. Even if it is trading at 28 times, let it trade at 28 times. Because you just talked about 28 times, but you see, market is trading at 28 times if you see FY18. The moment we factor in 20% growth in earnings, and let's say we start looking at FY19, and if this 20% growth happens, markets are trading only at 20 to 23 times. If you look at FY19, and if you build in another 20% growth for next 1 year, markets are trading only at 17, 18 times. So if I have bought a business which is delivering 30% growth, doesn't matter even if I have bought it little expensive. I'm not saying you can go and buy anything at any price or good business, at any price. It shouldn't be that way. But I should not really worry too much about, even if I paid a little bit extra for a business which has been growing consistently. If the objective is to hold on to it for 5, 10 years and make 10, 20, 50 times out, I should wait for such corrections, which if it happens now, to buy such businesses in even in more quantity.
Yeah, actually, I totally, you know, just to build on what Manish was just saying, very important, very, very thin line of difference between price and value. You know, for a long-term investor, a correction helps them get more value. Any investor who's only focused on price will panic. But a true investor who understands the underlying value of a business will be overjoyed because they are getting the same business at a cheaper cost. So there is, one must understand the difference between price of a stock and value of a stock.
That's very well said. Price is what you pay, value is what you get.
See, you always wait for MRF or Bajaj Finance or any good name you pick up, you always wait for them to come down.
Mm-hmm.
They just don't. As long as there's growth happening, 30, 40, 50% growth happening in the business, they will not come down. I mean, they are commanding premium today and they will keep on commanding premium till the time they are showing that kind of growth.
True.
So, that sounds fine. As a last question, what should be the investment, given the growth trajectory which you are expecting in the Indian economy, or I would say in the mid cap or the large cap stock, what should be the investment methodology which an investor can follow? Should they look at investing right now, or should they consider staggering their investments over a period of time? What would you like to say?
Buying in tranches is always a good idea. You are buying a good business, you are buying it at a good rate, you are buying it for long term, all that is fine. But buying it in tranches is always a good idea. Whatever surplus you may have today and you are likely to have in next some time, it is always a good idea that you keep on buying at every rate. As I said, if the objective is wealth creation, if you are not, you know, doing it to get that 5%, 10% here and there, then you can give it time. Okay, I am buying a business, I am reading enough about the business, and obviously it is a business which can probably deliver 5 times, 10 times, 20 times over next few years. So I bought it today at X price, I will probably buy it at X plus 10% 1 month later, I will probably buy it at X minus 10% 3 months later. Keep doing that. Keep doing that. Don't just try to time the market, okay, it is available today at X, what if it becomes X plus 10%? Let it become X plus 10%. Let it become X minus 10%. How does it matter? If the objective is wealth creation.
So can I sum it up that if you are looking forward to investing in quality stocks and you know what you're getting into, then anytime can be a good time to invest in the stock market.
See, that is what I was saying a while back, that market is touching new highs, making new lifetime highs. So market or Nifty started with 1,000, then probably 5,000, 10,000, today 11,500. So if you see 10, 15, 20 years, you know, markets are, or the opportunities we were talking about, which have delivered probably 50 times, 100 times. So there's always growth happening in the economy, in the businesses, in the market. Whether you buy it at 100 or 1,000 or 10,000, it wouldn't really matter so much if two things, you know what you are getting into. If you have bought a business which has been growing, you know, consistently on top line, bottom line, and you have in a way some understanding on it, or you have a good partner along with you to give you some good understanding on it, and definitely patience is the key. If you show patience, if you hold on to your investment, then only, you know, the effect of compounding will work in your favor. Compounding is such a beautiful thing, but how many people take advantage of that? Very few. Even if I bought an excellent business, 100 becomes 140, first thing I would do as an investor, which obviously I'm not blaming anyone, this is how our psyche works, that I will remove 40. Thinking, okay, now my, you know, investment is only 60 and I can do whatever I want to do with this 40. This is not how it should be. Because if you let it become 500, you know, or 300 or 400, you see the effect of compounding. Once your 100 has become 400 or 500, 20% growth after that gives you 100% on your investment. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
20% on 500 is 100.
Mm-hmm.
Initially, if you had put in 100, you see 20% growth happening after that. Your money is getting doubled.
That's really a good takeaway we have from this episode. If you have three P's with you, that is patience, persistence and power of compounding, then you will definitely create wealth in the long run. Thank you, Mayuri and Manish, for your time. Thank you, audience, for listening to this.
Thank you. Thank you very much.